Now we're going to cover another sort of ultimate integrated why. And it ties to something my pastor kept on teaching for a long time about the stages of spiritual maturation, which to my knowledge, nobody else but him kind of grasped. I mean, you know, there were a lot of pastors trained under him, so this knowledge is no longer just restricted. But there isn't anybody else who started it. So he invented a whole series of vocabulary for the stages of spiritual maturation so you could track yourself. And I tried to summarize those stages in LordVSatan3.htm and following. It's 3A, 3B, 3C. And then I did some videos on that called the Spiritual Maturation Process, which unfortunately had pretty bad audio, but you can still understand it. And there's a document, a six-page document in there, where the spiritual maturation process is mapped, including diagnostics, so you can tell where you are. And this is really the integrated why that's going to be the subject of this audio. God is out to cause you to become, in your thinking, like Christ. Now, the trouble we have with that terminology is that we always are constantly, you know, influenced by our old sin nature, and so we're constantly thinking, well, if it's like Christ, it means I'm going to be a good person. No. That's really important to understand. Paul, make sure that you know that. It's not about being good. It's about thinking the way Christ does. That's Romans 7. And what does Paul explain in Romans 7? Zigzag. I have one thing in my head that I know is good and right and true. And then when I go to try to live it out, it doesn't work. And it's a torture to have standards that you believe in and love, and then you find yourself constantly failing. And not only you, but everything around you. Everybody is failing the standards of Christ. So imagine what it was like for Christ to be here, having those standards. And yeah, okay, he's perfect and sinless as God, but that's not good enough. Because as God, wanting everything to be free, he has to stay hands off. Imagine being him, here constantly, every day, doing the same motions you are, going to the bathroom, eating, washing your hands, and you're living that low of an existence? And not only that, look at all the problems. He's God. He can just snap his fingers and all those problems will go away. But as God, he's not supposed to do that. That's what Satan was tempting him to do in Matthew 4. It's really very sad that our pulpits are not teaching what the Bible says. So we don't appreciate why we even have a Bible and what kind of message it's giving us. When you see Matthew 4, all you think of is, oh, he's so good and he passed the temptations and the devil was tempting him and he said no. That's not the purpose of Matthew 4. The purpose of Matthew 4 is so that you can understand what it was like for him to exist. The purpose of Matthew 4 is to understand your so great salvation. Because here you are living a low nothing life, but you're yet supposed to have the Word of God living in you. It's terrifying. It's upsetting. It's horrible. Every single moment I breathe, I don't want to be here. That's what Paul was saying too. Absent from the body, face to face with the Lord. I wish I was dead yesterday. That's what he's saying in Romans 7. It's torture to be alive. Once you are thinking like Christ. Because A, that's all you can do. And B, no matter how much you think you're obeying those standards, you're not. And whatever you are obeying, you can't do a thing about anything else in your life but live with it. Now that helps you appreciate how great your salvation is, because sooner or later you get to the point where you just are so glad the day is over. One less day I have to live on this planet. I'm one day closer to death. Thank you, God. I wish I was dead today. Maybe I'll be dead today. Because the difference between your high standards in your head and the inability that you have inside yourself to live up to those standards and the total lack of the world living up to them, it's excruciating. I mean, it's like wallowing in turds all day long. It's revolting. It's repugnant. It's an entrapment. It's like somebody threw you into a jail cell where a bunch of cockroaches on the floor. And every, you know, once a day, somebody throws an aluminum plate with some slop in it, and that's supposed to be your food. And you can't even get there before the cockroaches do. So now the cockroaches start to look good to you. And you're all alone in a windowless cell with, you know, just a slat in the door as your only light. And, you know, if you go to the bathroom, well, you're going to the bathroom in your own pants on the floor. There's nothing. That's what it's like to live here once you have God's standards. It is that kind of entrapment. It's that kind of disgustingness. You're looking for relief any way you can get it. It's enough to make you go crazy. And then you begin to understand what it was like for Christ to have to be here. Him being who he is and do nothing. Now it sounds, very understandably sounds, masochistic and sadistic that God would have this as one of his integrated whys for our life here. Walk a mile in my shoes. But if you want to know God and you want to be with God, aren't you going to be curious? Well, what was it like for you to be God? And why the heck do you want to be God? Why create this? But that's the heart of the whole angelic conflict. This is Satan's big argument. Why do you let it be so bad? And why don't you do something about it? That's his taunt. In Matthew 4. Why don't you do something about it? Oh, you poor thing, you're so hungry. Why don't you speak these stones into bread? And that's pretty much the tone he's using in the Greek. It's called the imperative of entreaty. He's being really polite and really nice, and he's allowing himself a genuine concern that Christ is hurting himself so much, and, you know, he can't say something like that without the sly dig. You know, you're stupid and father's stupid and you're being a masochist and a sadist and father is too. Since you're the Son of God, why not speak these stones into bread? Why do you allow this bad problem to occur? You're God, you don't have to. Similarly, as you start to mature in Christ, your standards change. the things you used to enjoy, you don't enjoy anymore because they're too small. It's like when you were a baby, a rattle, or, oh, red, oh, blue, oh, green, oh, yellow rubber ducky. Yeah, and when you got a little older, you didn't want to see that rubber ducky, and in fact, it kind of like embarrassed you because you used to like it, and you want to distance yourself from it now. Yeah, and you have friends and family, and they're still playing with the rubber ducky. But you're not. So now you have trouble being around them, too. And especially here at Christmas, that's where this stuff really hits. You know, we all have to go and visit the relatives. And some of our relatives are like 2 years old, going on 60.
Oh, I see these pretty lights. And, you know, you're going to drive up to Hastings Ranch?
You know, that's a place in California where they all do up their houses. And I remember every year we had to go up to Hastings Ranch and see who tried to outdo who in all their Christmas lights in front of their house. And I mean, they really went to a lot of trouble. Okay, and in Chicago, oh, I forget the name of the street. It was Lake Street. They did the same thing in Chicago. It's actually in the suburbs, in Lake Street. And I don't know, I'm sure they've got Memorial Drive in Houston. Every single town has got some part of that town where the neighbors all try to outdo each other at Christmas to see who can have the most reindeer and the most fancy lights. And, you know, it all lights up at night and they all preen and all the rest of it. There's going to be somebody in every family who's going to want to do that. Okay, and when you were younger spiritually, you liked it, but you grow out of it. Then there are all the people who are hung up on politics. And when you grow up spiritually, you start to realize how childish the politicians are, how they lie. They all do. They all do. Some of them are nicer about it than others. Some of them are more skilled at it than others. And you start to see just how fake and hypocritical everything is. And nobody cares about the Bible. Thumping it, yeah, in order to think well of themselves. They wouldn't know what it said if it bit them. There's not one person running for presidential office today who calls himself pro-life who has any clue what the Bible says. And is actually spitting on Christ. And is going to be voted for. People are going to actually vote for some candidate because he says he's pro-life. And they will think themselves holy. And they're spitting on the Bible. Just spitting on it. If a Muslim used the Bible for toilet paper, that would be nicer than what these pro-lifers are doing. And they don't even know. But you know. It's really hard to live here. That's the bad news of the integrated wise. What it was like for Christ to have to, oh man, live here? Oh, you people, you know, he called us little faiths. I forget where that is in the Bible, but that's the literal translation from the Greek. Little faiths. If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, which is the smallest seed that there is, okay, then you can move a mountain. How can you be so dumb? Christ was constantly frustrated with us. And you see him say so, you know, because he's teaching about the frustration, so that you'll know what it was like for him. And it becomes that way for you too. That's the bad news. It's just breathing down here. Whether your life is nice or nasty, it's fingernails on a blackboard 24/7. It really is. But that's what it's like for God. So here you get your window of empathy for what it's like for God to do this. That's the bad news, the bad side of it. And as always with God, the thing that's bad about a thing is also the thing that's good about it. Whatever's good about something, the very same thing is also what's bad about it. What's good about love is also what's bad about love. What's good about hate is also what's bad about hate. What's good about work is also what's bad about work. What's good about leisure time is also what's bad about leisure time. That's the irony of everything in life. And it's design. It's very ironic on purpose. So the good thing about what's bad about the spiritual life that I just outlined is that you realize it doesn't matter. Now, there are three stages in spiritual maturation that my pastor was explaining and that I show in the that Word document. Link will be in the video description to both the videos and the Word document and the web pages on all this. The good thing about this spiritual growth that makes life intolerable is that the very fact that it's intolerable is okay. Because it doesn't matter. My pastor tried to describe this in three different ways to represent stages of maturation. He called the first one, and the terminology he uses kind of has to be explained, let's put it that way. He called the first stage of spiritual adulthood cognitive self-confidence. And then he called the second stage cognitive independence. And then he called the third stage cognitive invincibility, which is really what I was trying to get at in this audio. Cognitive invincibility. Cognitive. You know something. Doesn't mean you're living it out. Doesn't mean you're being a good person. You just know. Invincibility means that, you know, nothing can conquer. It's, you know that nothing can conquer. I know, what was that? I know I can do all things through him who strengthens me. That's Ephesians, what is it? Or Philippians. Philippians 4:13? I got it on my refrigerator. Hold on. I have it in Portuguese on my refrigerator. Wait a minute. Yeah, it's Ephesians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's a cognitive invincibility statement. At the very time when it's almost impossible to survive, the fingernails on a blackboard, constant going against your standards. At the same time, the pleasure is that you know it doesn't matter. Everybody else is living on a hallucination, basically. You're becoming freed, successively freed of the hallucination as you know and know and know more. And as you know more, it's much more painful to be alive because you actually are becoming more alive. Everybody else is living on, you know, a hallucination pretty much. And then they get this whopping wake-up call. At times and at the end, that all this time was for nothing. Just one great big waste. And you find that out too, but the difference is that it's like, oh, thank God it's a waste. It never meant anything. It never mattered. Whatever your life is, good, bad, or indifferent in the eyes of the world, it's going to end. And you're happy about that. It's not upsetting. It's a relief because you've had the fingernails on the blackboard for so long. You're tired of it, and you're really glad to go. It's a victory. It's a vacation. It's good news that life ends. But you sort of get like flashes of recognition about it being good news long before the end occurs, because you start to realize, you know what, it just doesn't matter. Did you have a bad day today? It doesn't matter. It's over now. Did you have a good day today? It doesn't matter. It's over now. For a lot of people, that isn't how they're going to react to it. They're going to be tearing their hair out, angry. They're going to try and tell themselves that, well, they have good memories. You're going to make up something because there's this desperation that they had all these ideas and living on the hallucination that come the end of the day, the hallucination's gone because the day's gone. And for a brief moment before they start hallucinating anew, they realize, well, it's gone now. You know how we are. You're getting ready to go to a party, or we're getting ready to elect a new president. We have all this anticipation and hallucination about what can be accomplished. And then, of course, when it finally happens, nothing. It's incredible how every 4 years in America, we go through this. Oh, the next president is going to accomplish so much. Yada, 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 yada. And honey, right after the honeymoon period of the first 100 days, it's not happening. And by the time the 4 years starts to be up, we can't wait to get rid of the guy. I don't care who he is. Everybody was all hot to try to get him voted for. He finally gets in office and he thinks he can accomplish something too. And before the first year is out, everybody's jaded again. Doesn't matter if it's a Democrat or a Republican. And honey, it doesn't matter what country it is either. New king, new queen, new parliament. You know, France is going through this new love affair now with Le Pen's granddaughter, I think it is. Granddaughter. Or maybe it's his daughter. And she thinks she can accomplish something. And it's kind of nice that they're taking away, they're going to stop being so anti-Semitic, which is France's big downfall. France has always been anti-Semitic, and it's always gotten them in trouble. You can't be anti-Semitic without your country getting ruined as a result. Of course, that's why there's so many Muslims there. So much anti-Semitism means that the Muslims were welcome, and the Muslims are ruining France. But, oh, you know, we elect this blonde girl. She can accomplish something, and she, of course, believes it because she's only 21. Yeah, and after she's been in office, if she gets in office, she lost the first time, apparently. When she gets in office enough at 5-10 years, then they'll get jaded too. Or Germany with Merkel and that problem with the Syrian refugees. Or, oh, we can defeat ISIS. Yeah, fine, you defeat ISIS. What good is that going to do you? You know, we got the next party. You're 15 years old and you're going to your first, you know, I forget what they call it. And when you're 15, they had the same practice in Rome. You become an adult. You know, they have all these parties. Oh, life is looking good and future and yada, yada, yada. When you're 25, it's not going to look so good. When you're 35, it looks even worse. When you're 45, and you're starting up a new job, it's so neat, wonderful. Yeah, and 2 years after you've been in that job, you're looking for another one. You get married, your first, year maybe, if you survive it. That's the way we are. We hallucinate the outcome before you get there. And then when you get there, well, you can't hallucinate anymore. With life, it's like that, too. We're always hallucinating about tomorrow. Okay, and when tomorrow comes, well, then it's today, and it's not so much fun, and we wait for it to be over. In the spiritual life, that happens, too. But if you keep on maturing in Christ, what grows up alongside it, the wheat instead of the tares, is, you know what, it doesn't matter. It's okay that it's no good. It's okay that it hurts. It's okay that it's fingernails on a blackboard all the time. God wants you to come to that recognition. It's a recognition. It's not a conquering in the sense of you becoming a good person. This is the big problem in spirituality that, you know, Christians just totally mistake what it is. They think that as you mature in Christ, you'll become a better person. No, that's not even the purpose. It's not even possible. What happens as you mature in Christ, you become a happier person, despite everything not meeting the standards, because you know Him. And because you know Him, you realize, well, you know what? It doesn't matter. It's not that it doesn't matter of the resigned soldier from Vietnam, because that was one of their catchphrases. It don't matter. It's not resignedness. It's a kind of, I don't want to call it, a ha-ha. I can be washing a dish, and because of the amount of the doctrine that's in me, I'm having a greater impact on history than the President of the United States. That's a fact. I didn't create that fact. That's a fact that the Bible says, promises. Okay, high made low, low made high. The same thing is true for you. If you're learning and living on Bible, there's no, all the world's wealth can't compete with that. God can just do anything He wants, and He will, because He wants to express His pleasure that you're learning and living on Bible. Matthew 4:4 always occurring. God is infinite. He will always experience that moment. He always has. So His expression of His pleasure in that moment of seeing you learn something while you wash a dish. There's all the wealth on the planet, all the power on the planet, all the diplomatic work on the planet, all the politics on the planet cannot even begin to compare. So there is more influence and more power in your washing a dish while you're learning and living on Bible than all the stuff that's ever been done in Washington and all the other political capitals of the world from time immemorial. And in fact, they're getting the time to be immemorial because you're washing the dish. Because you're washing the dish. Before you, somebody else was washing a dish, and that's how come you can be washing a dish, because they were doing the same thing. So the people who we consider to be the movers and shakers of history aren't. They have their livelihood and their existence justified by all the dishwashers. Sometime in the 12th century, there was some maid feeding hogs. But she was thinking Bible when she did it. So everybody around her got blessed because she was doing that. She didn't know that was what was going on, and they didn't know that was what was going on. But when we're all dead and we're in heaven and the real story of history is told, that's the kind of story we're going to hear. Some retarded little boy sitting in a hospital bed right now. He's so severely retarded, he's not expected to live. But his mommy taught him a couple of things in Bible, and with God, you know, it doesn't matter how retarded you are. And he keeps thinking that same thought about God over and over and over. And now I lay me down to sleep. Perfect example of this was, you know, the movie Elephant Man. John Merrick, and that's a historical person. He was, you know, severely impacted. I wouldn't necessarily call him retarded, but it was worse than that. But he knew the Lord's Prayer. You can get a lot of understanding about God out of little bits of Scripture. And for some people, that's all they ever learn. Okay, but if you keep playing it over and over and over again, don't you think God is going to, like, elaborate on the meaning? For years and years and years, a lot of people, all they got access to, and they had to memorize it. You couldn't even touch it. They got access to a couple of Psalms in the Psalter, or a couple of verses in the Gospels that they heard the preacher preach. And then they memorized them, and then they'd spin their flax, or they'd feed their hogs, or they'd thatch their roofs, and they'd think about those things. And that was all the Bible they had. Of course, today it's really embarrassing. We have scripture like never available before, and we disrespect it like never before, too. I can learn in 5 minutes what took my pastor 5 months to figure out. He didn't have the technology. And yet we are spurning the Word of God like never before. 200, 300, 400, 500, 600 years ago, people had, like, maybe in their whole lifetime, they knew like 20 verses in the Bible. They never even saw one. They heard it on Sunday when the itinerant preacher came around. And he gave them some garbled version, no doubt. But God knows how to correct the garbled parts. And if you play it over and over and over in your head, he'll do that. What I'm trying to say is that the blessing to this world that has accrued is not through the politicians and the armies and the armed forces and the political systems and the economies and the rulers and the principalities and all the rest of it. It's because somebody was learning and living on Bible while they did something menial. Or maybe not menial, but definitely learning and living on Bible, no matter what they were doing. God blessed the time. That's why you and I are still alive today. That's cognitive invincibility. That's why it doesn't matter what your life was today. Good, bad, or indifferent. Did you learn and live on Bible today? Then that was a good day. Did things go wrong at the same time? Yeah, sure. Did you feel menial and stupid and worthless, and maybe everybody laughed at you and maybe nobody even noticed you? And so it's like, you know, I'm not doing anything good or important. So what? You learned and lived on Bible. And guess what? Even if your life was meaningless today and tomorrow and the next day and yesterday and all the yesterdays prior, it don't matter. You get to know Him. He's not looking for you to, you know, be little goody two shoes or little Lord Fauntleroy. He wants the time with you. That's why I made you in the first place. You in me, David said. What was that? You with me. Psalm 23, I think is verse 6. Thou art with me is, I think, how they translate it in English. It's really you, comma, with me, like a shout. You with me. You, Father, you, Son, you, Spirit, with me. I get to be with you right now. Of course, that was David, with, in Hebrew, with, together with, kerev, in the midst of. That's all they could have. But we, church, get it better. You in me, in Him, in Christ. How many times is that in the New Testament? You in me. Okay, and like Paul said, what do I care what man can do against me? Or is that David? Both of them said that. Paul at the end of Romans 8. Who cares what man can do against me? I get to be in you. Ha ha. See, ultimate revenge on life. Okay, I'm washing a dish and I don't feel too good. I feel fat and ugly and stupid. Or I'm in a hospital bed and I just got cancer. I'm waiting at the bus stop. I'm bored out of my mind. I'm stuck in a you know, the airport, or, you know, standing in grocery line, or I have to sweep floors or clean toilets. Oh, who cares? I get to be in you. What can men do to me? What can this life do to me? That's cognitive invincibility. And see where it comes from? It's a fact. It's cognitive because you realize it's a fact. Nobody can separate us from the love. Thank you. Nobody can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. End of Romans 8. That's a fact. Now, when you're in your latter spiritual stages, that becomes your, like, daily bread and butter. Before you get to spiritual maturity, you start to realize how true this is. It hits you at times. You even cling to it, or you want it to be true at times, but you don't really know how much a fact it is. But in your latter stages of the spiritual life, it's cognitive. You know nothing will separate you. You know it doesn't matter. You know this. You recognize it. You see it be true. In the beginning, you don't see it be true, but you want it to be true. So you claim it as a promise, and it's perfectly legitimate to do. You and me, God, you and me, you and me, you and me. I've lived on that knowledge for a long time. I wrote about it in the Lord v. Satan 3-page long ago. 10 years ago now. 15 years ago. I live on that knowledge. But now I'm seeing it be true. It's a big difference. I knew it was true, but I didn't see it be true. I didn't have cognitive invincibility then. I got it now. And yet, I'm miserable most of the time. But this is also true. So the misery and the contentment and the cognitive invincibility and the fingernails on the blackboard and my own, what do you want to call it, incompetence and everybody else's incompetence, all these things are hitting at once. They're all true simultaneously. That's to mimic omniscience. Matthew 4:4, always occurring. Everything at once is how God, as it were, experiences his own life. A billion years ago, a billion years from now, and now is all now to him. We're so small, we can't experience time like that. We have to experience time as being incremental. This minute, then the next minute, then the next minute, then the next minute. Think about, squint your eyes. Okay, squint your eyes real tight. So it's just very, like your eyes are slits. And you can barely see anything at all. Okay? But you know, okay, that there's outside of what you can see with your nearly closed eyes, there's a whole picture there. God's eyes are totally open. We experience life, as it were, through slits of eyes. So we can only experience a little part of the total reality at once. And that's why it seems like it's moment following moment following moment. But it's really all one great big now, as it were, on a single plane. And you've heard the scientists sort of talk about this as space-time. Okay, they're wrong about the way they're characterizing it. But the sense of it being one great big now, they're right about that. They don't understand how it works. But it's like everybody's on the same plane, but you don't perceives that. It seems like there's time is moving. What's really happening is you're moving. But it's like everybody's moving on the same plane. Okay? It's like everybody moving on the same road. Okay, the road is actually a hole. Like, for example, you have Route 66. It's a whole road. but where are you on it? Okay. God sees the whole road, experiences the whole road, and everybody on it at once, before they even exist, and after they've long gone. That's what it's like for God to be God. Okay, how do you, as a human being, have empathy for what it's like for God to be God? You have to get to the place where you have all this stuff hitting you at once. Cognitive invincibility being the recognition that, oh, this is, today is gone. Yesterday is gone. Tomorrow isn't here yet, but it doesn't matter what it is. Because the one big nowness is that it's invincible. Your relationship to God is invincible. The fact of that being true, you see in your head, of course. Whereas you want it and you hear about it being true long before you see it being true. And the seeing is actually an understanding. You know, like Paul says at the end of Romans 8, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. He knows that. It's not just an affirmation or a goal or a desire or a belief. It's a reality. And the reality is something that's already true before you know it's true. But over time, because you're learning and living on Bible, the hallucination peels back like the layers of an onion. And finally, you see how true it is when you're in maturation. Now, prior to that, cognitive invincibility being the last stage, and, you know, how long does it last? I don't know. It can be a long time. I've been in it for a while, so I don't know how long it'll last. I'm 62 now. I could die tomorrow. You know, if God keeps me around for 20 years, well, then if I don't slide back, you know, I'll be in it for 20 years. Who knows? But it's a knowledge. It's not how good you are. It has nothing to do with being good. It's a knowledge stage. Okay, prior to that, once you start getting spiritual adulthood, you like my pastor liked to call it cognitive self-confidence, which, you know, that's a misleading term in a way, because it's not you being confident about how good you are. You're just confident. The self is confident and you're aware of it. And what are you confident about? God. What are you confident about? That you know what the Bible really says. You also know you have more to learn, but you actually see it. You get it. You're not living on somebody's hearsay about what it is. You see it yourself. You're confident yourself. That kind of self-confidence. It's not confidence in yourself. It's confidence in God. And it's the self that's confident. So it becomes cognitive, because you know, self. You're aware that it's the self who is confident about God. You're not living on somebody's claims. You know, so that's what we all are doing. You know, the world pretty much. Is that somebody says something and you're believing what they say, but you don't know it's true yourself. That's way too much of that's going on in the world, especially with Scripture. People make all kinds of statements about Scripture, and they don't even bother to do their homework to find out what it says. You know, I did those videos on Exodus 21:22, showing that the fetus is not a legal person. And yet you've got all these presidential candidates running around trying to claim that abortion is murder. Why? Because they heard somebody else say that that's what the Bible says. They don't have any knowledge of it themselves. Because if they did, they'd know that verse and they'd know that the claim is false. Abortion is not murder. The Bible says that flat. Abortion is not murder. There's the verse to tell you. Exodus 21:22. But they don't know that. And yet they call themselves Christian and they're lying and spitting on Christ. Because they don't know that. Well, cognitive self-confidence means you start to know that. You start to know what the Bible actually says yourself because you see it yourself. You understand it yourself. You learned it yourself. God gave you a teacher and you sat under that teacher. And for the longest time, all you're doing is living on what the teacher says. You don't know it yourself. Just like it is in regular school. You go to kindergarten and you're told all this stuff in first grade and second grade and third grade. And finally you get enough knowledge built up in your head that you can actually start analyzing yourself. And then there comes a day when the knowledge you've heard all your life, you actually see it for yourself. And it's not because someone told you it's true. It's because you now see it yourself. That was the promise. What was it? In Jeremiah 31, verses 31 through 34, which is echoed in Hebrews, what was it? 8, verses 8 through 12. And then the bookend of that section of the point ends at Hebrews 10, verses 15 through 17. The promise there is the second covenant, you know, the new covenant promise, the New Testament promise that you won't have any need for anybody to teach you. What does that mean? What that means is that you're not living on hearsay. You're not living on somebody else's claim about something being true. You see it yourself. In other words, if you grew up, and this was famously done in Plato's The Republic, when he's talking to Glaucon about how humanity lives in a cave. If you are constantly believing somebody telling you about the sun, and the sun is in the sky, the sun is in the sky, you've never actually seen the sun in the sky. But you believe the person telling you that the sun is in the sky. And you learn, okay, the sun is yellow, it's hot, it's blah, blah, blah. Okay, and then one day, you're no longer living in the cave. You actually go outside and, oh, now you see the sun in the sky. Now you wouldn't, if you didn't have all that prior teaching about it, you wouldn't know what you were seeing when you saw the sun in the sky. But you got the teaching. It was hearsay to you. You didn't have any direct knowledge of it. But because of the kind of teaching you got, once you did see it, you could recognize it. That's cognitive invincibility. That's cognitive self-confidence at the beginning stage. Now, cognitive independence is in between the two, where cognitive self-confidence would be where you see a thing and know it's true yourself. But you're not really, how do you want to call it, so well-versed in seeing it yourself that you are independent of anybody else's statements. But you keep learning, you keep learning, you keep learning, you keep using. And yeah, you always have a teacher, but at the same time, you can see it yourself without your teacher. And you actually can, what do you want to call it, not exactly improve upon, but you see extra things about it that your teacher didn't talk about. Or maybe talked about, but didn't talk about much. And now you see all this extra stuff. Okay, it's like you went to school and you learn French. And then you go to Paris. Now when you were in school and you learned French, you learned some things about Paris. The Left Bank, Montmartre, Chartres, and all these other places. Okay? But now you're actually going there. So the stuff your teacher didn't say, you now see yourself, and you're still, in a way, referring to in your mind stuff your teacher said, but you're seeing a whole bunch of stuff your teacher never talked about. So you have independence, now a cognitive independence. And then, to sort of keep on with that analogy with French and Paris and all the rest of it, cognitive invincibility in that topic would be It doesn't matter what anybody says to you. It doesn't matter whether life is good or bad, or whether people tell you you're wrong or stupid, or whatever they say. Nothing can take away the fact that you know what Paris is like because you've been there. It's the same thing in the Christian way of life. Oh, man, how many people come running around saying,
well, Jesus was not a historical person, or Jesus was a historical person, but nobody ever said he was God until he was dead,
and all these other things that people come up with. And you know better. And they can make up whatever they want, or make any claim they want, and you can just sit there and smile, because you know better. See, it's invincible in that no matter what anybody says, you actually have independent, personal knowledge and experience with it. And they can say whatever they want all day long, and you just smile at them and say, well, you have to prove it. No, you don't. Well, prove it to me. Well, you get the proof yourself. You know,
well, if you can't prove it to me, then God doesn't exist. Okay.
I mean, you don't even need to bother talking to them anymore. Those kinds of arguments don't disturb you. So it's invincible. It's an invincible knowledge. Notice how, in all cases, it's not about you being a good person. It's about the knowledge being direct, the knowledge being in you, the knowledge being, as it were, more and more. You're more confident in it, you're more independent with it, and it's more invincible and unassailable, and it doesn't matter if people agree with you or not. So it doesn't matter what your status is in their eyes. It doesn't matter what your status is in your eyes, because the fact is the fact is the fact, and you know it's a fact, and that's enough. You know God, and that's enough. To know, what was it? To know Him and the power of His resurrection. To know Him and the power of His resurrection for the purpose of conforming to His death. It's Philippians 3:10-14. I guess Philippians is important in this audio. That's it. That's cognitive invincibility too. And then you end up doing what Paul says in Philippians 3:14. He just threw that at me. Catasco pon dioco ai sto bravem te sano glesius tu teum Christo Jesu. Onward I go toward the goal with the upward call in Christ Jesus. In other words, boom, 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 plod, plod, plod. That's your motive for plodding. Because remember, the fingernails are still on the blackboard. So you're going through what omniscience goes through. All the bad, all the good in your life, all happening at once. Now, that's total integration. That's the why of it, so that you can have, like Paul says in that verse, the fellowship of his sufferings. So it's a way to be with God, because this is how it is for him. Now, the amazing thing is that this is what he chooses it to be for him, and that's always an amazing question that I still, to this day, don't know how to explain. I mean, he loves it. That's the answer, but that's an integrated why, isn't it? Peace out.